Hey, what's up everyone? Tim here from Everyday Tactical Vids. Today we're talking about designing a survival knife. This is the first video in a three video series, and this is the knife we're talking about right here. This is the T17 designed by Eric at Outer Limitless, and we're going to talk through the entire process. So three videos in this series. Video one today that you're watching is basically the thought process that Eric went through, his discussion with me as I picked out the particular angles and tweaks I wanted on my knife. Video two is the unboxing. Video three is the testing of the knife. And so we're going to talk about basically how he came up with the idea of designing a knife, what he was looking for, what he offers you as a customer if you want to purchase one of these knives. He basically gives you a ton of customization options within the knife. The size of the knife, the steel, the handles, the sheath, just a ton of different customization options. So this video is me having a conversation with him as basically I learn about his thought process, and then I basically make my requests to him about the different style of knife that I want. So this video is a full rundown of that process. Video two is going to be the unboxing. Video three, like I said, will be getting out there and testing the knife. So if you've ever wanted to design a knife, learn about knife design, wonder where do you even start, you know, how do you reach out to a company, how do you get someone to build it for you, all those things, this could be a really good video for you to learn about designing knives. So right now we're going to cut over to the portion of the video that's my Zoom chat with him, and you'll see that conversation. So thanks for tuning in and check out this video to learn more.
Hey, Tim, what's happening, man?
Hey, man. Good to see you.
I just wanted to say thank you very much for having me on your channel today.
Yeah, it's awesome to be connecting. I was thinking about it today when I was driving over here to my office. We probably, like maybe 2 years ago, we first started like going back and forth a little bit. And then all of a sudden I see you on YouTube and I'm like, okay, I can tell from his accent. He's not from Alabama. He's from this part of the woods. So pretty close as far as our physical distance from one another, just a state away. So it's cool.
Yeah, no, it's fun, man. And, I've been a huge fan of Everyday Tactical Vids for a long time. I mean, I've probably been watching you since right around when you started. So,
oh, wow.
I mean, you know, I'm an early adopter I'm probably here today, quite frankly, because of the work that you've done. So thank you very much for everything. And, like I said, I am a huge fan.
I appreciate that, man. That's nice to hear. Well, likewise, man. Likewise. And I think actually I'm thinking about it. The first time we talked, you were coming up with some collaboration ideas, and then you even offered to do some logo work for me, which was so nice. So I appreciate that. We never got a chance to connect, but once COVID dies down, we'll get out in the woods and do some reviews together, I'm sure.
Well, I'll tell you, that would be fun. And I would greatly enjoy that. What I'm hoping is that today your audience is really going to enjoy what we're bringing to them. Your audience doesn't know me much, so I think I'll just step into this real quickly. My name's Eric Outer. I am the host of the YouTube and social media channel, Outer Limitless. I'm coming here today to bring you, Tim, and also your audience, what I coined the T17 project. So, well, I already told you that, you know, I'm a big fan of your channel. I looked at it, you know, you've been doing this for about 8 years. You're real close to about 1300 videos, if what I was looking at is correct. And yeah, in that time, I mean, a huge amount of those were on knives, right?
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
So, I mean, you know, you're a guy that obviously knows how to handle a knife. And you have your likes and your dislikes, and that's part of being a reviewer. Mm-hmm. Well, for me also, you know, I'm at the point now, I'm coming up on 5 years running my channel. I have about 685 videos, and of those, 211 are knife or blade related. So we're heavy channels on blades and specifically fixed blades too. So, well, you know, the thing about a knife, and there's really, in my opinion, not the perfect knife. But, you know, each one of them, and they can get close, but each one of them has, in my opinion, a little bit of a deficiency. Now, I'm going to pick a little bit today on the SE6, which for me was the knife that really was the first, like, real stout survival wilderness blade that I learned how to use a survival wilderness blade and truly trusted. And if I'm not mistaken, you actually came to the table a little bit late getting your hands for the first time on an SE6.
I did. You are right. You're right.
And I think by the end of it, you were like, and I now see why everybody likes this one.
And I've never used an SE6 before. And after having used both these knives, I'm like, I can see why people have liked them a lot. I've used other SE knives and liked those, but these really excel at being a an overall woods knife or an overall survival knife.
That's me a little bit. I mean, that's my first Leatherman wave too. It was like 8 years into the wave and I was like, I'll get one. Then I was like, late to the party, but better late than never, I guess, right?
Hey, you got a lot of stuff to do and a ton of gear to review, and they land on you when they land on you. So right, that's right. The way it goes. But so again, the SE6 to me, even though I greatly love and appreciate this blade, well, this is limited in how you can get it. Now, I'm going to premise this by saying you need to go back to when SE wasn't making the contoured handles. Okay. So I'm going to, set this up a little bit. My thought process in this T17 project goes to when the SE6 was a slab sided knife. If you wanted to get the contoured handles, you had to go to the knife connection or get a custom maker or something.
Sure. Okay.
You're stuck with jimping. You're stuck with an unsharpened spine. It came coated. If you wanted to, you could strip it. But if you wanted to get into some different types of features, you're either stuck without them, or you have to go to the aftermarket, or you have to go to somebody custom. Well, right. That got me thinking. And to be honest with you, the straw that broke the camel's back was when I had the Top Silent Hero. I like wanted to love that knife so much. Like the profile was there and just it had those the curve and the appeal to me. And I just naturally gravitated towards it physically. But then when I got it in my hands, the blade depth was a little too high and it didn't quite work. And I was like, that's it. After reviewing all these blades and trying the Silent Hero a couple of times, I bought two of them and got rid of both of them because I couldn't do it. I was like, that's it. I am going to make that in my opinion, kind of reverse engineer some of the deficiencies that I see in knives that you can't configure. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to tell you, it's not perfect, but I have found a way to essentially give you a repeatable result, right? Because you can take an SE, you could take your SE, mm-hmm. you could hand it to me, and I could pop it in my sheath and it's going to fit. Or I could take my SE and give it to you and you could pop it in your sheath and it's going to fit, right? So we found a way to make a repeatable result from copy to copy to copy, yet give you the customization that you need so that you get the blade in your hands that you actually want. And so, well, with that said, I mean, are there any blades that you've ever had in that same sort of vein where you're like, man, if I could have just changed that one thing, it would have been like that home run?
Yeah, it's funny you mentioned the Silent Hero. I felt the exact same way. Actually, I got the Silent Hero from Tops and was going to use it as my instructor knife when I was doing, usually once or twice, I'll do a class, a wilderness survival class, and that was the knife I had. And I picked it up. I do like the blade profile overall, but the handle was just way too thin for me. As soon as I picked it up, I'm like, when I have to pick up a knife and kind of re-maneuver my hand a bunch of times to get a grip, I'm like, no, I can't do that. I want to pick it up and just go with it. So that's why I've got the SE6 here. It's funny you mentioned those things because on the six, so this is a newer one. It's in the Venom. I've got the HM, which more kind of a little bit more of a bushcrafting one with the rounded handle. And then I've got an original SE6 that's much more beat up. But this one, what do I like about it? I like the blocky handle. I don't like tons of contours. I like to just be able to grab a hold of it and not have to kind of maneuver my hand in the proper position. The jimping for this one is okay for me. The reason it's okay is that it's on the, it's coated. And so if it wasn't coated, I think it would beat my hand up a little bit more, but I could do probably a little bit less for the jimping because if I have gloves on, I've got an even better grip. If I have gloves off, I just don't need that digging into my thumb as much. I do wish that this had, I do like the look of this one, just it's so like kind of out of the box. But I do prefer a 90-degree angle so I can throw a spark up the spine. So that's a preference for me. Those are the two things that kind of jumped out to me. Maybe an SE6, if they made a 7, I'd like that because I really do like the Rat 7 from Ontario Knife Company. But you can't get it in a 7. You get a 6, a 5 is chunkier, the 4 and 3 are too small for me. So that's a preference thing. But the jimping, the coating on the blade, the lack of the 90-degree handle, those are things that, again, to your point, I could probably get this to somebody who could, clean it up for me, take the jimping off and stuff. But at that point, I'm like, I probably spent a couple hundred bucks. It's not worth my time, I don't think.
Right.
So.
Yeah. Well, all right. I'm glad you brought some of those things up, because that just reaffirms my thoughts that I think you're going to really enjoy this. And I think, you know, your viewers and subscribers are going to like it too. So, well, for everybody watching, again, my name's Eric Outer, Outer Limitless. If you're interested in anything you see, please reach out to me at outerlimitless@gmail.com. You know, you can find me on my YouTube, Instagram, and Facebook, all at Outer Limitless. And again, this is the T17 project. So with that said, why T17? Well, I was doing a little bit of research. I was actually trying to provide a video and get it all produced and put together on D2 tool steel. D2 to me is a steel that I was kind of interested in getting more involved with and really understanding it. And I did a bunch of research and I happened to find these guys called TFK, and it's Tanev Family Knives. And I reached out and they had these beautiful knives. So here, this one here is called the T7, and this one here is called the Pico. Both of them in D2. I reached out to them and said, I'd love to buy a couple of your knives. And they said, yep, here you go. They sent them out and I did a review on them. Now, in the meantime, I was getting fed up at some of the things that we had just talked about. And I was working on packaging up this project. And I actually reached out to a couple of US manufacturers. Specifically, I was looking at Tops, and I was also looking at Battle Horse Knives. And just after, you know, talking to them and after seeing the quality of the knives from Tanev Family Knives and really getting to take a liking to these guys, I kind of threw a shot across the bow and said, guys, like, I have an idea on this project. Would you be interested in this? And they were emphatic and came back and said, yes, we would absolutely love to work with you. And I took a chance on them and I said, okay, you know, they're two brothers, same age as me, and they're, you know, early 40s, trying to make a name for themselves. And I was like, you know what? Like, I just have a feeling about this. Let's go with it. And so we teamed up. And the reason why T17, well, their models start with the T because of Tanev Family Knives. So that's the T. And my lucky number is 17. So is born the T17. So without further ado, here is the original T17 prototype. Mm-hmm. So going into this, the original idea for me was some basic core values. So in essence, what I really wanted is to have a good quality stout wilderness survival blade that was configurable. So again, being able to configure it in a number of different ways. It was nimble and had ergonomics, but at the same time had the sort of lightweight and easy capable carry system that would allow me to get this deep into the wilderness. I do spend a lot of time hiking and camping and backpacking and going deep into the mountains. So that was the main thing for me. So this here is the original prototype. Now, this is based on a 6-inch blade profile. We've since the original come up with a 5-inch and a 3.5-inch. And we're currently in the prototype stage with a 4-inch knife. So all of these knives that I'm going to show you today are all configurable, but the original, again, being based on that 6-inch platform. This is now called the T17.6. So even though the original was the T17, now that we have multiple sizes, .6 for the 6, .5 for the 5, .4 for the 4, and .3 for the 3.5-inch, but it's really a 3. So again, that's the T17.6. All right, so customizability, right? So again, going back to some of the things that we talked about, you have a lot of different likes and dislikes and things that you may want to work into a knife, and especially if it's going to be a survival blade, because you really want to have that comfort and you really don't want to fatigue. So the things that you can pick, for example, we offer a number of different handle materials. We also offer both a contoured handle or a slab-sided handle. So again, depending on which you like, you know, you can pick if you want the contoured or the slab sided, because, you know, I know, just as you had mentioned, some people like the contours, you know, they want their SE6 with the contoured handles. Maybe they want the slab sided. Now going into the jimping, that's another option that you can select. So sometimes people like jimping. Well, sometimes they don't. So here you'll see this particular knife with no jimping. And another major feature that you see is this one here with the finger choil. This one here has the full length cutting edge. So again, trying to sort of cater more towards that buyer experience, saying, well, you know, I would really love that, you know, quote unquote SE6, but I want that full length cutting edge. Well, SE, you can't do that, but here you can. So depending on your exact likes and needs, you can see a bunch of different options here. And then the final thing you'll notice is that there are different finishes. Again, this allows a couple of different blade steels and different finishes. So for example, here, this one here is a darker acid stonewash finish. This one here is a satin finish. And real quick, rolling in this particular knife, you'll see this one here is more of a gray. That's a tumbled finish. And finally, the last thing that is an option, which is pretty cool. So this one here, you'll notice, has sort of a dark spine. That again is, that's the standard spine. But what if you want it nice and sharpened so you can really shower sparks? Well, even though this blade has the acid stonewash finish, here you'll see that spine completely sharpened and squared off. Now, both of them will scrape, but if you really want to do some scraping and really, you know, shower the sparks off like a ferro rod, you can get the 90 degree sharpened spine. So those are the available options. And what do you think, man?
Well, let's talk about a couple of things. So tell me about your steels. D2, obviously, right? Because that, I heard you're a fan of that. What are the other options that you're offering?
Yeah. So, well, part of the reason why TFK in caught my attention was originally because of the D2. That is what they specialize in. So they specialize in D2 and also N690. So we're using European steels. You'll see this is stamped with 1.2379. That is European standard D2 tool steel. And this is Bohler N690. So German Bohler N690. Those are the two steels we offer right now. I am hoping in the future we are going to have other options, but we're going with what we know because we can nail a heat treat. We know the properties. We know how they're going to behave, and we've tested them and we trust them. So that's where we're at with these right now in terms of the steel.
And so your N690, probably, I'm guessing that from what I know of it, you got more resistant to corrosion as opposed to the D2. Now, both of them are going to, if you stick them underwater for 6 months, they're going to be nasty, but the N690 is going to hold up better. Right? Is that true?
Yeah, that is true. And in fact, what I've found is I can actually get a little more of a refined edge on the N690. I get a little more of a toothy edge on the D2. Both of them performing extremely well. I've tested them both down to about 0 degrees Fahrenheit, and they have performed very, very well. No deformation of the edge. I would say that I find that the N690 is a little more field sharpenable. The D2 tool steel is pretty tough. And people will say that you have a hard time sharpening D2. I personally don't. I do a lot of ceramic rod work, and I do a lot of leather strop work, and I haven't had any problems. But I don't also personally typically chunk an edge real hard. So I'm mostly doing touch up and strop and honing rather than true like sharpening. But yeah, I have found it's a little easier to touch up the N690 than the D2.
Yeah, that's just a hint for if you're watching this and you're new to knives, if you're always having to sharpen your knives, it means you should be pulling back a little bit and just touch them up more often. So what I generally do is, you know, I try to touch up after each time I use it, and it doesn't take 6 months, you know, to like, you'd spend literally 10 minutes, 5 minutes, maybe just putting an edge back on it and you're good to go. So that'll answer sort of the D2 question if people are concerned about it. I guess if you beat on that thing for 6 months and don't touch it at all, you're probably gonna have to work it a little bit more, but hey, most people aren't going out into the woods for that long. You go out for a day, you come back, touch it up a little bit, put some oil on it, you're good to go. So N690, actually, the first time I had any experience with that was with the first Benchmade Triage. They built that with N690, so it was a little bit more resistant. If police and, you know, firefighters were out there in the rain cutting somebody out of a car, they're not worried about, oh, I stuck this in my pocket, forgot it, and it got all rusty. So, right. And I like that, especially up here in the Northeast, man. We get snow, we get rain, we get humidity. And so something like that, nice to have that as an option too. And obviously D2 is a good steel. I do feel like, honestly, D2 gets kind of a bum rap sometimes because people are like, oh, it's a tool steel. Yeah, but it's about how you take care of, you know, most steels. If they're garbage steels, they're garbage. But if they're a good steel and you get good heat treat and you take care of it, they're going to last for a long time. Right? Is that been your experience so far?
I absolutely agree 100%. And I think D2 is at this point. I mean, it used to be the upgrade to 1095 and people right. forgot about it. Now it's super steel, super steel, super steel. Well, you know what? D2 is a super good steel. It's just right. not in that classification of super steel. So right. I've had extremely good luck with it. I do like D2. I think it's a quality steel in a lot of different ways. And especially with a company that specializes it, I definitely say, you know, I recommend it.
Yeah. And as people who like SE, the thing is, you notice that the SE6, even when they came out with their new contoured handles, they didn't put in an S35EN. And I don't know if you saw the video, but Patrick Rollins over at SE snapped one of the, I think it was the SE4, because the S35EN is a great steel, keeps an edge, good retention for the edge, going to resist the weather, but it's more brittle. So there are advantages to having something that's just like big and beefy, or something that has a little bit more flex in your steels.
Yeah, no, that's a huge point. And again, why when you're specializing in something, kind of staying to it sometimes is a good formula. So, right. you know, right. for SE, the 1095 and that Rowan heat treat, you can't beat it. Why, you know, kind of in a way, why stray from it? And the other right. one thing that I'll mention about these particular steels, which is nice, I do a ton of food prep. Sometimes with a carbon steel, it can leave a little bit of a taste, or like that sort of irony sort of taste on your food. But these particular steels, because they are a little more on the stainless property, don't do that, which is nice. And I can say that definitively, one of my best kitchen knives is this particular.
I'm gonna say, it looks like a kitchen knife. It's so clean.
Yeah, it's got that profile. And believe me, these knives have been severely used, and I'm not going to say abused, because I mean, I hammer my stuff hard, but somehow it's just not abuse. Yeah. So, you know, yeah, but this is one of my favorite kitchen knives, and these are my keepers and my users. So one last thing I would like to mention about the handles. So these particular knives do start at $195 with, you know, the D2, and then it kind of goes into some upgrades. And for the $195, we do offer like a micarta, a couple of different styles of micarta, and then G10. Usually they have liners. You can pick whatever you want for liners or colors and all the different features, however you want to configure the knife. And then we go into the sheaths. So the sheaths are pretty darn important, because I've always said, and I know you're going to completely agree, a sheath can make or break your user experience. If you have a sheath and it's not going to carry your knife well, that's going to be a bummer.
Yeah. And that is exactly the silent hero, because the leather's nice, but I don't know if you remember, I got something maybe a little bit similar to it. Like this is a Kydex, but on the Silent Hero, the strap came over like this. And so every time you drew the knife out, you had to make sure to get that little leather strap out. And I only once just nicked it, but I took, you know, maybe a 16th of an inch out of it. And all of a sudden, every time you're putting that knife away, it's not like you're in a rush necessarily, but you got to look down and be like, okay, is that all right? Whereas with a Kydex or a good sheath, you're just like, click, all right, I'm going on to the next thing. So yeah, it can make a big difference.
Yeah. Well, so with the sheaths, for example, we do offer a number of different options. So factory from Tanev Family Knives, they make their own leather. They do a beautiful job, just very nicely done, black or brown, and right hand or left hand carry. These are capable of being a belt carry or the dangle style. The dangler can be removed. To each their own. And it's just a simple pouch style. It actually buries fairly deep, which is nice. So when you actually bury the knife into it, you do get nice coverage, good overall retention, and then nice. plenty of meat to get on the knife and draw it back out. Yep. So that is the factory TFK sheaths. And I also work with a guy, Zony 59. If you haven't seen him, he's actually on eBay, but makes some incredible stuff. So
wow, look at that. He had
nice sort of survival rig made. And again, you do have the ability to put the dangler if you so choose, or belt carry. And then you can also do a scout carry on that. Wow. So these are really nice, super well made as well. And then really for me, the key and really my favorite carry system is the Kydex. So Mark Irving of Extreme Edge Custom Kydex, we kind of co-designed this together. It was my brainchild in design, but he's the fabricator. So putting together our thoughts, we came up with a very nice carry system. Now, this is how it comes. You end up with your fire steel holder. And the interesting thing is you get this at whatever size you like. Mm-hmm. So for example, if you like your half inch, you can get a half inch. If you want smaller, quarter inch, or you know, anything in between, You can order it to size. Nice. So we'll actually make you your fire steel holder for the size of the ferro rod that you want on your knife. We include a bunch of hardware. So your tech lock here. So your typical sort of blade tech lock. But we also offer, or I shouldn't say offer, we also include the Blade Tech Molly locks. And we've built an adapter plate. Now, this adapter plate can go either on the front or the back of the sheath. And the cool thing about this is, and if you're like me, and I know you are, you like your Maxpeditions and your Van Quests, right? So one thing that's pretty nice is if you put the Molly adapter on the front of the sheath, well, you can easily attach something like a pouch. So mm-hmm. similar to some of the other sheaths that you'd see on like your SE can, you know, you can get the, and they do a, their sheath is actually very nice and reasonably modular if you get the Molly backer and some yep. of their pouches. But this is the same idea where now you can actually configure this, but with whatever pouch you want, and it's standard spacing on the Molly, which is nice. So that's pretty cool option.
Sweet. Oh, look at that.
And then, yeah, so if you put the Molly on the back of it, that'll easily fit on any Molly. So, you know, slides right on there, no problem. So depending on exactly what you want, you end up with your tech lock or you end up with your Molly locks. Mm-hmm. And the fact of the matter is it comes with both of those and the ferro rod holder. So very versatile and gives you a number of different options. And one thing that is important about the TFK T17.6 sheath from Extreme Edge Custom Kydex, because we have all these different blade configurations, we do mold them all with the finger choil. Reason being, if you look here, now that fits perfectly as it was molded with the finger choil. But what if you're a repeat customer and you come back and say, well, I really only want one additional knife, but I don't need to buy, you know, a whole new sheath. Well, your full length cutting edge fits in there perfectly as well. Nice. No problem at all. Retention's great. It's not going anywhere. Zero rattle. So, I mean, you know, those are the little things that we've tried to pay attention to because we know people are going to complain about rattle. They're going to want compatibility, and everything on here is standard spacing so that, you know, all of your additional accessories or third, you know, aftermarket or additional things that you may buy are going to fit this sheath as well. So nice. Very flexible and versatile.
Cool. Can you get it in that clear style like that?
You can get whatever you want.
It's so, kind of cool. Well, that's kind of like that.
It's neat, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah. You kind of know what's coming at you.
That's right. That's right.
So that is the T17.6. Now, one thing I'm going to bring up real quick is some of the handle options. We talked real briefly about, you know, say for example, G10. But if you wanted to continue to upgrade your knife, and this is available through all the different models, so keep this in mind as we go through the other models. But this one here is sort of a mosaic. Mm-hmm. This handle is made by a guy named Wayne Walker. Now, I found Wayne Walker because he makes beautiful little bushcraft knives. And I actually bought a custom knife off of him a while back, and I took a liking to him. And I started watching him on Facebook, and I was like, dude, his handle work is just spectacular. And I knew I wanted those on my knives. So I commissioned Wayne Walker to make a number of different handles. And as you look here, you'll see it is sort of that, you know, it's a mosaic style. We end up with dovetailed burl wood. So that's a maple burl wood. And we have the oatmeal burlap micarta. And then cool. on the inside, some different liners. And this could be made a ton of different ways. So depending on what people like. Now, that is a significant upgrade, but it can definitely be done.
Sweet. Those are cool. Those are really nice.
Yeah, this is pretty. And this is my first keeper. So this is actually unit number 17, which I kept 17 of all of them. That's I don't good. Even have number one myself. But yeah, this is unit number 17. And yeah, so those are the Wayne Walker custom mosaic scales.
Sweet.
And the one that I've been showing you since the beginning, this here is a resin. So an epoxy resin handle made by Voodoo Resins. So Matt Peterson of Voodoo Resins does beautiful work. And these are the Voodoo Resin. This particular color is called Ice Flower.
Sweet. And I'll have to get all these links to these guys to you and put them in the description section so people could check them out. And, you know, if they've got a knife that they want a particular handle on, I'm sure you want to promote these guys and the work that they're doing. So we'll let people know about them.
Yeah, I appreciate that, man. They are an integral part of this team. I couldn't do any single one part of this without the entire team. So, you know, they work hard. They've put a lot of expertise into all of this. So I do appreciate that. And I know they will too.
Let me just ask you something. And we'll talk a little bit about kind of where we're going with this in future videos. But I think there are people out there who, like, I know a bunch of people have made their own knives, and there are people who are maybe customers, you know, in the knife community, but they don't know the ins and outs of production process and all that stuff. And so they look and they're like, oh, dude is making bank off all this, man. He's just like rolling in the dough. So give people a sense of, and you don't got to give me the exact numbers, but give people a sense of what the, you know, investment looks like, what you're making on profit, where you're like, no, I just want to barely break even or not lose too much or just make a tiny bit. Give them a sense of what it's like to invest in this process.
Well, and I'm glad you say that, because I personally handle each and every one of the sales on these. So I invest a huge amount of time with every customer. Mm-hmm. You know, when you talk about all these materials, and when it comes to the colors on the handles, I also spec all these. So, you know, I personally do a lot of work to set up each and every one of the knives that I configure. And I have a massive database that I actually maintain. I have a database of each and every one of my customers. These are individually serialized, and I know all my customers that bought them, and I track that. When it comes down to the actual manufacturing, there are so many steps that go into each one of these blades, and it can take a while. If you order a custom knife, and I'm not going to lie, it could be, if you're lucky, 6 to 10 weeks is the quickest, and it depends on where I'm at, and I'll get into a little of that detail. It could be maybe as much as 12 to 16 weeks to get your hands on one of these. But when you think about it, these handle scales, okay, they're made by Voodoo Resins. Matt Peterson needs to go to his suppliers. He needs to purchase his resin. He needs to basically at that point break out his forms, pour this in it. He calls them recipes. So he has to pour this recipe, and then they have to cure. At that point, he has to prep them completely. So they're just a nasty slab. He has to machine them and plane them and square them and cut them. Then at that point, they're finally ready to go. He does kind of a rough polish just for his photos on Instagram, but then I'll box them and send them to me. So then there's a shipping move there. Oh, I got to take these. I photograph them so that I have them ready to actually show my customers and say, hey, you know, this handle is available. From there, once I get that prepared, I have to then send these to my manufacturer, and they're in Bulgaria. So I ship these overseas, takes a number of days, makes it to them. So then from there, they're still handle slabs. They actually have to rough machine these into shape. Now, if you notice, and it's going to be hard for you to see, but I'll give you some close-up photographs. There is legitimately no lip. I mean, they hand sand all of these to perfection to get them exactly fit to each one of the knives. And these are pretty much what's considered to be a mid-tech. So the manufacturer, TFK, has to source all the materials. They then have to, at that point, get their general stock cut to rough shapes. Then from there, they do all their grinding work, all the polishing work, all the fitment work. And then from there, they have to either sell them direct to a customer. But typically what happens is they come back to me for stock, or I have pre-sales that I've already sold and I need to ship those off to the customer. So when you look at the number of moves on these and how much goes into it, it's pretty insane, all the way down to small details like laser engraving and the bolts. And, you know, when I go to my manufacturer and I give them a list of 20 knives and each one's configured a little bit different.
Right.
And that's just the knife, never mind the sheath option. So whether I'm going leather, right hand, left hand, black or brown, different, you know, options on the sheath. And now you can pick your ferro rod holder. There's a lot of detail, and I track all that. So yeah, if you looked at dollar per hour and what I make off this, if I'm making 15 or 20 bucks an hour off this, I'd be surprised. But it's not about that. For me, it's not about that. It's about doing something that really, I don't think anybody else has quite done this yet. It's not done to the same level of detail, and you'll see some more pretty soon. I have some more sort of goodies to show you. That's a little behind the scenes on the manufacturing process. It is quite involved.
Yeah. I made a video a while ago from Blade Show, I don't know, probably 3 or 4 years ago. And it's entitled something like, "Why Are Topps Knives So Expensive?" And people were like, yeah. And then, you know, the people who bought Topps knives and use them, they're like, I don't know why people are complaining. Like I know
right.
And Tops is, I mean, Tops is not a couple brothers in Bulgaria doing work. They're a pretty big for their size manufacturing company. They're not, you know, 700 people, but they've got a big team of people who are working on their knives. But it's still, you know, I mean, you see the videos probably on Instagram. They grind them and then they're cutting paper with the Elchete and stuff like that. So take that and shrink it down to a handful of people and then put somebody in Massachusetts, put somebody in Bulgaria, put somebody in Rhode Island, put somebody in Texas. And it takes a while to get all this stuff done. So, you know, at the end of the day, I think what I want to say to people is if you're a collector and you just want to get a ton of knives, then go buy some cheap stuff at Walmart and that's cool. Like good on you. But if you want to say, you know, I want to invest in like one knife that's really like, this is the one I love, then it's a process to get there. And I just want to say real quick, I was thinking of it before, but LT Wright is well known for using 01 tool steel. It's a tool steel, but they know how to do it. They know how to treat it. They know how to take care of it. And people love the Genesis and other knives that they put out. So in the same way, if you get D2 or the N690 and you know how to handle it, it can be an awesome, awesome knife. So to people who are listening, just because it doesn't say S and then the 30 number after it doesn't mean that it's not a good steel. You just got to be open-minded to actually, it's not just the numbers. It's how people handle it, heat treat it, all those different things.
Yeah, no, thank you for saying that. I appreciate that. And yeah, again, and you know, if you decide that you like the design elements and the thought process, it's something that you can't really get from somebody else too. So, you know, you're paying for the design, you're paying for the thought, and you're paying for the experience. And that's why I personally facilitate each and every one of the deals, because I want to make sure that people get exactly what they want. And I want to have that personal connection with them. And you know what? I actually have some like friends that came out of just buying a knife off. Like that's why I'm doing this. Yeah. It's not to be famous. It's not to, it's really not even to make money. All I really want to do is make enough money to make more knives.
Right.
If I get a couple in my hands that I get to use and I get to make a new design, I'm a creator. That's why I do YouTube in the first place, to create. Everything else is secondary and bonus.
Right. So let's talk about where you and I are going in this adventure that we're on now with this knife.
Yeah. So, well, all right. I'm just going to run through a couple last ones because it's important for you to see the rest of the lineup. So this one here, this is the T17.5. Now I have two models of the .5. I have a .5L, which is a long handle, and a .5S, which is a standard. And if you look at the length on the L, it is the exact same handle as the .6.
And now, is that 5 a resin handle too?
It is, yes.
That's a really slick looking handle there.
Yeah, that's called Stargazer. So that again is Voodoo Resins, and that's in the color Stargazer.
Cool.
Pretty cool.
Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, no worries. And one subtle difference, and it's important though, is on the .6, we have roughly a 3/16 steel. And on the .5, this is a 5/32. So 5/32 is that sweet spot between the 3/16 and the 1/8. 1/8 to me would be too thin for a knife of this size, but that 5/32 is that sweet spot. So it leaves it nice and slicey, but yet it's durable enough. And the thing about the long handle is you can chop. You can still do some chopping with this. The 6 is awesome for chopping. The .5L, you can still do a little bit of limbing. If you have bigger mitts, you'll see it's going to index nicely in your hand. But let's just say you want that sort of equally proportioned blade to handle ratio. That's why we have the standard. And my personal keeper, again, unit number 17, you'll see here is actually the S model. So the .5S, and that's a pine cone right in there. So we've been, again, so this is Voodoo Resins in pine cone. And if anybody's interested in any of these knives, I do have a batch of pine cone scales at the manufacturer. So with TFK right now, ready to go. And I'll get into some of the build details in a little bit, but that's going to be important. So what I have invested in and sent to the manufacturer could impact what you can actually buy at any given time if you want something made quickly. Right. So I do have a number of these pine cones right now. So this is my personal keeper, the .5S.
Sweet.
And then just real quick, getting into the details on the sheath, very similar. The sheath, right hand, left hand, dangler, pouch sheath. So we have these. And if you like sort of a more traditional style and you're not going to cut your strap off, We do also offer a slightly different style. Now, these ones here are better for the S model with the standard handle. If you're going with the longer handle, I would suggest going more with the pouch sheath, just a little bit better retention, and it's better balanced is the main thing. Right. And then finally, last thing to bring into consideration is we also have the exact same setup with your Kydex. So again, the Extreme Edge custom Kydex sheath for the T17.5. This also comes with the Molly adapter plate. So if you like that Molly adapter plate and you want all the hardware, that's another option. Same thing, customize your colors. You know, you can customize the size of the ferro rod holder. And again, you get all that hardware. So that's the Kydex option. So real quick, I'm not going to go into too much detail. Here's my Dot 4. So we are hopefully in the next week or so going to have a working prototype in my hands. So the idea here is the 5 is sort of more of that like belt knife, but the Dot 4 is going to be more of that sort of bushcrafty knife. Mm-hmm. So I want to have that survival wilderness blade. Then I want to have the belt sort of hunting knife. This is going to be more of that bushcraft style knife, and it'll be similar outfit in the same sort of way. But the final option here is the T17.3. Now the Dot 3 is sort of that EDC companion blade. It's that small little sort of, I don't know, for me, I started believing in a two blade system. I was always a one, you know, find that one tool option. I'm like, I don't know, hold the horses. I'm more of like a two blade guy now, I think. Mm-hmm. And having just that little companion blade that does like 80% of your work, you know, cut the line, you know, cut your food real quick. This with a sharpened spine is the best ferro rod striker. You're not wielding around like a 6-inch blade. This is just, you know, and all the knives, and you may or may not have noticed, but I love scallops. I put those on almost all my designs because I love alternate grips. I love the ability to grab the knife from the side and just do that, you know, kind of alternate grip work. And having the scallops there just really helps with the index, which I greatly enjoy. So something that's extremely important to this particular part of the build, and what I'm going to show you here is, so again, going back to the T17.6, if I break out, well, here's my Dot 3. Let's say you're a repeat customer and you're like, oh, well, I loved your Dot 6, but now I want a Dot 3. Well, you can like mix and match all the hardware to like really make this work, and it's all compatible. Now, the T17.3 comes with this adapter plate, okay? Now, you get your Molly lock. You also get an Ulti clip, which is awesome for front pocket carry. Mm-hmm. You can take your ferro rod holder off of the Dot 6, mount it to the front of the Dot 3, and with this adapter plate, you can easily take this, if you so choose, slide it in, and now you have a real clean piggyback ride. Mm-hmm. So if you're somebody that wants to really build out your system and you like the idea of piggybacking your knife, well, that all fits in there perfectly. Real sleek, works very well. Again, you know, you could Molly attach that to your pack. You could swap this out and put the Blade Tech lock. If you have a dangler that you like, you could put that on there too. So just a huge amount of things in customizability, depending on what you're trying to do.
Sweet.
And so something else that we wanted to bring to the table, and this is taking it to the like extreme next level. You may have noticed as I was holding up the slab sided knife, well, there was some texturing.
I did notice that.
Right?
I did. So yeah.
Texturing on the handle. What's that? This has a clip point and serrations. This one here is a long clip point, mm-hmm. also with serrations. So because of the magic of DB Hemlock, Hunter Cutchin, who does incredible custom work, we have taken a number of my base platform T17.6s and now given them a completely different profile. So if you wanted to go to the nth degree of customizability, we can do that as well. So everything from raindrop patterns.
Wow, that's cool.
And serrations and napping. So if you see there, to this one here, this is again my personal user. I kept this one, which has that crazy splatter. And here, this has right hand serrations when this knife here has left hand serrations.
Nice.
And if you notice, most knives that have serrations come with left hand serrations. But if you're a righty, you really want to use that blade profile to your advantage. Now, I don't usually like serrations on a fixed blade, but here having the right hand serrations works.
Nice. That's cool. That's really nice.
Other options that take these again to the next level.
Nice.
So with that said, that is the lineup. That gives you a pretty good overview of all the different blades. At this point, man, I would love to hear your thoughts and see what we can do to custom configure one of these knives for you.
Well, Eric and I have talked before, so I kind of knew things were coming this way. So I've been watching and learning as I'm going here. So I'll tell you what stands out to me. I mean, first of all, I love the 6-inch blade. I think that's a really nice size. I do think it's funny because some people on like 5-inch is the standard, 5-inch and bigger for wilderness survival. For me, 6-inch and stand and bigger, because I'm thinking about if you got a baton, you just want a little bit extra length, you know, for that process. So 6-inch, I think is a great size. I love that pine cone look, man. I don't know what's you've got available. I think that's really slick right there.
Absolutely. And what I'll do, and for the viewers, okay, now if I was working with you via email or through like Instagram or Facebook chat, I'd be zipping you over some pictures. So what we're going to do when we get off of this call, if you're telling me you like pine cones, I'm going to send you a quick photograph of a number of different options, and you can see if one of those you like. Now, if you don't like those and you wanted to pick something different, I can order you whatever color combination you want. You just need to remember, I got all those moves to go back to Voodoo to say, hey man, can you make these slabs? So we got all that work building up and all that time to the point where I get them in my hands and I can send them to the manufacturer to when they can finally start to make the blade. And that's where the time comes in. People don't always understand that.
Yeah. I did like that. What was it called? Something with moon, the resin one.
The Stargazer.
Stargazer, moon star. I'm missing it all.
You know what? I have pine cone Stargazer sitting there right now.
Yeah. That's lucky. So, I mean, those are sweet. I'd be interested. Give me a sense of what you think. How would you compare the jimping to like an SE6? As aggressive, less aggressive, the same?
Yeah, that's an interesting point. I would say it's a little more aggressive. And the only reason why I say that is because if you look at the actual pattern on it, it's a coarser pattern. This is a finer pattern. So it is a little bit coarser. Yep. We have approached the jimping a couple of different ways. I had the second batch. It came out a little bit square for me. I felt as though it was a little bit sharp. Mm-hmm. So we're trying to soften that up on the edges. My personal thoughts at this point is, in listening to you, you'd probably rather go without the jimping. And that's my just impression, but I don't want to talk you one way or another. So I would say it may be a little bit aggressive for your liking.
All right. Well, I mean, you're the pro here. So let's go no jimping.
Okay.
I'm definitely a 90 degree spine kind of guy.
Okay.
I do like the finger choil. I do. It's weird because as soon as I pick up a knife, the first thing I do is I hold it like this. I always put my finger up there to say, okay, because I'm going to be doing that detail work.
Yep.
I think a lot of people, when you get your first survival knife, you're like, what can I just go hacking at? And then when you actually get out there, you find out that you're doing more of this type of stuff. You want to do a bow drill? Once you get a piece of wood, you're carving down, your finger is up as close as you can get. You know, I remember I did a survival outing one time and I actually had this knife, which is from Three Dog Knife, a custom. This is LMAX steel. I mean, it's super expensive. It took me a long time to get a hold of this. But I had this guy and I was just waiting to use this for everything. And I had an SE Azula on my neck and I used the Azula 90% of the time for all the work I did. I did some chopping for making some steaks, but the vast majority of it, I was using a small knife. So I just like to be able to choke up. I think that's it right there.
That's why. Cause I mean, I got to the point where I was like, you know what? You just need that little tiny knife to do so many things. So
yeah.
But all right.
I think the satin finish is beautiful, man. I think that satin is actually really, really nice. What do you have for grinds on these knives? Or maybe I asked that question already.
No, I blew right past that. So all of these are saber ground. For me personally, I do a ton of batoning, even though a lot of people don't believe in it. I'm going to get crucified. But to me, a saber grind works. Right now, these are all drop point design with a saber grind. We actually, on the edge geometry, it's a straight up V grind. but they go between like they're around 17 degrees. So it's fairly slicey. You'd be surprised. A lot of times when you get into the larger knives, you go a little bit more shallow for durability. But again, I haven't had any problems with my edge. Minimal chipping, almost none. Minimal rolling, almost none. Mostly strop work and ceramic rods to get it back. So they nailed the edge geometry on this, good and slicey, and they do a good job with the heat treat. So, that's the blade geometry and the grind.
Yeah, that saber grind is my favorite, I would say too. A lot of people start to mess around and try to get convex and stuff, and for me, it's probably true for you too, right? It's like, you don't have time to like spend 500 hours on every single backpack or every single thing. So when I get a knife, some people like to sit and watch Netflix and mess around with their knives. I'll cut my hands off if I do that. I can't do two things at once. So I like to be able to just like touch it up and go. And so trying to put a special edge on it, saber grind, that's easy for me to clean up, like you said, with a strop or with a, with a ceramic rod. So, I'm open to the steels. I really like the Bowler N690. I think that's a great steel. I think it's actually underrated. And if you go to Europe, I've worked with German knife shop probably a year or two ago, and a lot of the Puma knives and other knives, I'm trying to think what the other company is. It's got a little squirrel as the logo. I forget what the name of it is right now, but anyhow, they use a lot of N690. That's kind of a standard for them. It's kind of our 1095 sort of over here. So I think that's a great steel. I think it's underrated, honestly, in a lot of ways.
Good, good. All right, so we got you at a 6-inch blade with pine cone, probably in that stargazer pattern. What are you thinking about liners? What color liners are you feeling?
Ooh, man, that's interesting. I guess it depends on what the actual handles look like.
That's with the toxic green liners. I know it's going to be a little bit hard to see in there.
Yeah.
But yep, that's the toxic green, and the color of the stargazer kind of takes the hint and hue of the liner. So if you wanted it to go a touch blue on you, you could get a blue liner. If you wanted it, I maybe would stay away from red, cause I'd hate that to go pink.
Sure.
I personally love the toxic green.
What if we did this so I can have some of the experience of Joe and Jane customer? Why don't you shoot me some pictures at some point, and send me a couple shots, maybe on Instagram Messenger. We could chat back and forth about that. Yeah. And then we can roll some of those photos in the future.
Yeah, absolutely. And I would love for you to have that experience. So yeah, we'll do that for sure. All right. So rough thoughts right now. Stargazer, no jimping, 90 degree sharpened spine. You're going to get the finger choil with a satin finish. And the Bowler N690. So do you want your contoured handles or do you want them slab sided?
Oh man, that is a good question. I think the slab for me, I tend to be as neutral as I can get with the handle. So I think we'll kind of go in that direction with just the slab side.
I think you may be my first slab sided customer.
All right. Okay. All right. Well, we'll see what they have to say about it.
Good. Good. Okay. Well, nice. What about the sheath?
Whew, there's a lot of cool options, honestly, man.
Thanks.
I'll tell you what stands out to me right now is that I have so much Kydex that I'd be interested in trying something in leather just to kind of mix it up. This is your call on this one, right? So if it would be helpful to you to have somebody to review a particular style of the leather, I'm good with wherever you want to go. So what are your thoughts on that?
Well, why don't we do this? Since you're going to be doing a review, why don't I get you one of the TFK leather pouch dangler sheaths, and I'll make you an Extreme Edge custom Kydex carry system. You get your druthers on both of them.
That's awesome, man. That's great. Yeah, that's sweet. Thank you.
Yeah, of course. And I'll, again, because your options are custom, let's figure out the color combination once we figure out your liners and that you're happy with the stargazer, because you may change your mind. So we want to kind of coordinate here. So you got a couple options, but the good news is if you're going to be showing your audience this, they're going to get to see the surprise.
Right. All right. That's cool.
So, well, Tim, with that is the TFK T17 project brought to you by Eric Outer from Outer Limitless. So guys, if you see anything you like, please feel free to reach out. I really do try to spend a lot of time with every customer. That's the most important thing to me is, building the relationship. having, you know, hopefully some friends and some fun out of this. I really just want to get blades into people's hands, and I love seeing them made. I just love seeing them and the brainchild just come to fruition. So as much as anything else, it's about the creation process and the relationships with the people.
Yeah. Thank you, man. I appreciate so much your time, guys. I want to put links in the description section to this video so you can get all the details about the designer, certainly about Eric and everything that he offers. We'll put some links to his other videos so you can see. I've been watching this on YouTube. So when he reached out to me, he's like, hey, what do you think about this? I'm like, oh, dude, I've been following this story. So I'm another chapter in the story of what's going on with this, this adventure that he's on. So I will put links to all that information in the description section. You find out more about that. Eric, I know we're in the middle of the COVID craziness right now, but have you been to Blade Show ever down in Atlanta? Were you there?
I did go to Blade Show in 2019 down in Atlanta. I have not been to Blade West. And I also made it to SHOT Show 2020. So I have made it to a couple of the shows now, and they're just awesome, awesome fun. And if things behave, I am hoping to make it to Blade Show again this year.
Awesome. Also, it's funny. My family, we saved up for a bunch of years to go to Disney World, and actually based on that had to skip Blade Show that year and SHOT Show that year. So the 2 years you were those two, I was in Florida right before everything went crazy with COVID, but maybe this summer we can hang out down there, put this thing to use and, you know, see what other people think about it as well. So
I'll tell you, man, I would absolutely love that. So thank you very much. And I greatly appreciate your time.
Yeah, this has been great. So, hey guys, like I said, all the links are going to be in the description section. If you have other questions, you can email me, you can email Eric. We'll let you connect with whoever you need to figure out more details on this. In the next video, we're going to show you a little bit about the manufacturing process. We're not going to do tons of information about that, but want to see, you know, have you see what that looks like a little bit. I'll probably share a little bit more about my experience of what the build's been like. And then when I get a hold of this thing, I'm going to head out into the woods and use it. And we're going to beat on this thing. We're going to use it aggressively. I mean, you guys know, if you watch my channel, that I've yet to find the perfect knife. So I love SC. I really love Tops, but they don't make a perfect knife. And so same thing with this. I'm going to be, hey, here are the pluses. Here are the minuses. I will tell you, the fact that you can customize it starts to eliminate a bunch of the minuses right in the process.
Well, yeah, and that was the thing. I'm not going to get them all, but I got a lot of the big ones. So
yeah. Well, I mean, like you said, I couldn't call up somebody and say, I want the satin finish. They're like, yeah, we coat it. I'm like, what about satin? They're like, yeah, click. Yep. Whereas you'll say, okay, let me see what I can do with that. So that's awesome, man. That's awesome.
Nice.
So,
well, awesome. Right. Looking forward to it.
All right. Guys, thanks for tuning in. Like we always say, you know, we're on social media here. If you're not subscribed to this channel and to Eric over at Outer Limitless, definitely subscribe to him. And we'll be putting out more videos. Stay tuned for the next couple videos in this series. All right, everybody, take care.